Adequate notice of this meeting was advertised at Asbury Park Press and the Beacon on January 11th, 2024. It has revised and advertised on March 14th by posting the notice in the Forked River and Lenoka Harbor post offices and by filing a copy of the notice with the Lacey Township Clerk as required by the Open Public Meeting Act. And pledge of allegiance, please. To the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Mr. Bell?
Here.
Mrs. Armato?
Here.
Mr. Conity?
Present.
Mrs. Walker?
Present.
Mr. Armato?
Here.
Mrs. Claus?
Here.
Mr. Peters?
Present.
Okay, we're going to go into executive session. Be it resolved that an executive session be convened for the purpose of discussing confidential student matters, including but not limited to harassment, intimidation, and bullying, confidential legal matters, including but not limited to the current caseload, and confidential personnel matters. Subject matters of these discussions will be disclosed to the public when the reason for confidentiality subsides. The length of the executive session is estimated to be approximately 60 minutes, after which the board shall reconvene and proceed with business at 7 p.m. Action may be taken. Motion?
Motion, Peters.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Thank you.
Welcome. I'd call the meeting to order, please. Dr. Perry, you have the floor.
Yes, thank you. Welcome to our March board meeting, and thank you for being here. As many of you know, we have experienced another student loss in our community. Chelsea Deal tragically died recently, and I'd like to ask that you all join me in a moment of silence. Thank you. So these are difficult moments for all of us. The moment of silence we just had represents hope and healing our community must have after our recent student losses. And in doing so, this is a way that we're going to path forward. And through our community unity, we can continue to support one another as we approach the end of the school year. As I've said many times, we are in this together. We talked about this back in December, and back then we had a night of hope and healing. So on March 25th, and I'm hoping that on your way in you were able to pick up one of those flyers, we will host our second community-wide event with the Traumatic Loss Coalition, who has been absolutely amazing and supportive of our district. This event is going to be held right here at Lacey Township High School in the auditorium, and that will take place from 7 to 8:30 p.m., and I just want to remind our entire community that this is an adults-only event. Additionally, and in light of our recent losses, our priority is to provide comprehensive support for our students, all of our students, not just at the middle school and high school, but all of our students during these challenging times. We definitely understand the profound impact that these losses have had on our students, on our staff, on our Board of Education, on our administration, and that is why we have been working very hard with all of the support services that are in place for us to do what is necessary to support our entire school district. In addition to the evening with the Traumatic Loss Coalition, we will be sending information out about our second annual Mental Health and Wellness Night. This is in collaboration and in conjunction with Central Regional. That is going to take place on Monday, April 29th from 5 to 8 p.m., also here at our high school. For that event, we will be offering free dinner, free childcare, and free access to resource tables. So again, I hope you had an opportunity to pick up the flyer about our evening with the Traumatic Loss Coalition, and we will be getting the information on our second annual mental health night out very soon. In addition to what we have already done, we have been asked a lot about what else are we doing to support our students and our staff. So I have been working with Dr. Purpurai, Dr. Purpurai is our director of guidance here at the high school, who has been our direct link to the Traumatic Loss Coalition and another organization known as Compass. So again, our priority is to provide comprehensive support for our students. And some of the measures that we are taking is to bolster our counseling services to ensure that our students have access to professional supports. Trained counselors are available to provide individual sessions, group therapy, and crisis intervention to those in need. In consultation with the Traumatic Loss Coalition, we will be actively promoting peer support networks where students can connect with their peers who have undergone similar experiences. And in doing so, we know that, and we hope that this is going to create a safe space for sharing emotions, seeking advice, and receiving comfort from those who have experienced these things firsthand. We are also organizing educational workshops and seminars that focus on mental health awareness, coping mechanisms, and suicide prevention. The purpose of these sessions is to empower and to inform our students with the knowledge and skills that they need to navigate these difficult and challenging situations. To that end, I am so grateful to the Forked River Rotary for their generous support and donation of $20,000 to support our district in mental health supports. In fact, Dr. Purpurai is at the Rotary meeting this evening where they're presenting her with the check. And I can't even begin to tell you how grateful we all are because...
The Elks also offered to help out.
Yeah, so I was going to talk about that next. I happened to speak to a gentleman, Mr. Bard, from the Elks, who also is very, very willing and interested in helping us secure outside speakers to provide much-needed supports for our students and our staff. So I'll be connecting with him again tomorrow to talk about what that will look like. In addition to that, we know that engaging the wider community is crucial for providing the supports that I'm talking about. So we are collaborating with local mental health organizations. In addition to the Traumatic Loss Coalition, community leaders like Mr. Bard and the Rotary, and parents to raise awareness, reduce stigma, and promote open discussions about mental health and well-being. Another thing that Dr. Purpurai and Mr. King and Mr. Brandis and I spoke about is the importance of clear and transparent communication during these times of crisis. And you know, just because we're here now doesn't mean that this isn't going to continue. It's very important that it continues. It's vital that it continues. So we're going to be utilizing various communication channels, including email, social media platforms, district announcements to disseminate the important information that needs to get out to our families, especially when we talk about mental health and awareness nights like this and the evening with the Traumatic Loss Coalition. And then finally, we are continuously monitoring the well-being of our students and our staff to evaluate the effectiveness of our support initiatives. And to that end, we welcome feedback from our parents, our teachers, because that is what's going to help us improve and begin to offer programs that are perhaps a little bit more comprehensive, because again, we haven't been here before to this immensity. And then above all, we want to know that we want our students, especially our students, to know that they are not alone, that there are supports in place for them here in the Lacey Township School District and beyond, and that they always will have somebody to go to when they need somebody to talk to. And that right there is the part where we're going to spend a lot of time on. So we welcome the feedback from our parents, from our teachers, our entire school community about what it is that we're doing well and what areas we can improve upon. And when we get to the mental health and wellness night, many of us, most of us, will be there. That would be a good night for us maybe to set aside some time to talk about what that feedback looks like. So thank you, Mr. Peters, for giving me an opportunity to talk about that before giving Charlotte the floor to recognize our unsung hero.
So just to start off, SGA met on March 4th. The juniors are working on their May 2nd junior prom at the Holiday Inn in Manahawkin. Kiss the Senior Goodbye, which more information will be provided. And the seniors are working on the June 13th prom and senior events. And then the next meeting will be held on April 8th. And then at this time, I'd like to welcome March's unsung hero down to the podium, Rena Hamuda. And can we please give a round of applause for her family here tonight. The unsung hero for the month of March is a determined individual both inside and outside of the classroom. Rena strives to be great in all aspects of life. Her contributions to after-school programs, such as being a leader in the LTHS DECA program and a captain of the girls' varsity soccer team, she leaves an impression on everyone she meets. These are only a few reasons that Rena Hamuda is chosen as Lacey Township High School Senior of the Month. Unsung hero. Sorry, for the month of March.
She'll be senior of the month one day.
It's okay.
Charlotte's getting ahead of herself. It's okay. All right, Rena, congratulations to you and your family. Another round of applause to you. All right, Mr. King, are we ready for seniors of the month?
Thank you, Dr. Pereira, Board of Education members, people in attendance. It gives me great pleasure to announce March's Senior of the Month. The first Senior of the Month, spoiled the surprise a little bit. I'd like to call up Charlotte Fisher, please, as our Senior of the Month for March. A round of applause for her family in attendance.
Hello, we're here to celebrate our March Seniors of the Month. Our first Senior of the Month is Charlotte Fisher. Here's a video of her accomplishments.
I'm Charlotte Fisher, and I'm proud to be named March's Senior of the Month at Lacey Township High School.
Congratulations, Charlotte Fisher, for being named Senior of the Month.
Congratulations, Charlotte Fisher, on being named Senior of the Month.
Some things I do here at LTHS is I'm the president of SGA, Biology Club, and DECA. I'm the secretary of Interact, and I'm the blood drive chair for National Honor Society. In the spring and fall, I play tennis and golf.
Charlotte has been an amazing student in my AP Biology class last year. She is also president of the Biology Club for 2 years. She plans great meetings, great activities. She is very dependable. She is intelligent. She is an amazing person to work with. I really am going to miss her next year as she moves on to her next adventure.
Some of my favorite memories here at LTHS is painting my senior parking spot and playing against Ocean City in the state tournament for tennis.
You know, Charlotte, over these last 3 years you've been in the STEM Academy, you've truly grown as a person. You're a person who is now confident and understanding of what your goals and achievements are supposed to be.
Some things I like to do outside of school is hang out with my friends and family, go to the beach, and play pickleball.
Charlotte has a great personality. She is really fun to be around. I really wish her the best for the future.
My goals for after high school is attending a four-year university, majoring in biology on a pre-med track with the end goal of eventually becoming a cardiologist.
So congratulations once again, Charlotte Fisher, on being named Senior of the Month.
Congratulations, Charlotte Fisher, on this honor.
Thank you, Charlotte. Our next Senior of the Month for March is Bennett Talbot. Bennett, come on down. A round of applause for his family in attendance as well this evening.
Our next Senior of the Month is Bennett Talbot. Congratulations, Bennett.
I'm Bennett Talbot, and I'm proud to be named March's Senior of the Month for Lacey Township High School.
Congratulations, Bennett, on winning Senior of the Month. This is so exciting that another AP Chem student is winning. We are so proud of you.
Congratulations, Bennett Talbot. I'm being named Senior of the Month. I'm extremely proud.
Here at LTHS, I am a member of the Marching Band, Concert Band, and Jazz Band. I am the Vice President of the NHS. I'm a member of the Interact Club, co-captain of the robotics team, a STEM representative, a member of the biology club, as well as a part of the track team.
Bennett, you are an exceptional student in AP Chemistry. You are always helping everybody around you. You are guiding our class with intriguing questions. You're bringing things in from outside the classroom into the classroom. You're just amazing at everything you do, and we are so lucky to have you in AP Chem as one of the top students of this year.
Outside of school, I like to watch movies, go to Goodwill, sleep, play pickleball with my friends, work at the park summer camps, and work at Chipotle.
You know, for the last 4 years, I've watched you solidify yourself and your character. You're unique, funny, creative, out-of-the-box thinker, a person who truly understands what it takes to be successful.
Some of my favorite memories I've made at LTHS are last year competing at Robotics Internationals in Maryland, this past week competing at the state DECA competition where I did qualify for internationals, making friends throughout my high school career, and being a part of the band all 4 years.
So many of our class experience are enhanced by your amazing work ethic. Sometimes some of our class gets a little silly, but Bennett is always great at getting everybody back on track where we need to be by the end of the period. Thank you, Bennett.
After LTHS, I plan to attend Rutgers, where I got accepted into their six-year pharmaceutical doctorate program, where I plan to graduate and then pursue a field in pharmacology.
It is so exciting to see that you've been accepted to Rutgers University for their pharmacology program. You are going to do so well. I am very excited to see what you do in the future. I think you're going to blow everybody away. It's just going to be amazing, and we're so excited to see that.
So, congratulations once again, Bennett Talbot. I'm being named Senior of the Month.
Congratulations, Bennett. And our Vocational Senior of the Month for March is Rocco Schmidt. Rocco, come on down. A round of applause for his family who are in attendance tonight.
And our March Vocational Student of the Month is Rocco Schmidt. Here's a video on his accomplishments now. Congratulations to all the seniors.
I'm Rocco Schmidt, and I'm happy to be named March's Senior of the Month at Lacey Township High School.
Congratulations to Rocco Schmidt on winning Vocational Senior of the Month for March.
Congratulations, Rocco, on winning Vocational Student of the Month.
Some of the activities that I'm a part of at the high school are the fishing club.
Some things that set Rocco apart from the rest of the students are that he's calm, collected, organized, always on time, and he has great attention to detail in his schoolwork.
My favorite memory here is going fishing in the bay on the tuna thick.
Rocco is always smiling in the classroom and adds a little spice to whatever we're doing, which makes the class much more enjoyable.
After high school, I plan on continuing my carpentry career, and then one day I'd like to own my own business.
At the beginning of the year, Rocco shared with me that he won first place in his carpentry skills competition at vocational school. I believe he even wrote his senior essay about it. And he is now currently enrolled in his second skills competition, so we wish him the best of luck.
Outside of school, I like to go fishing or I'm at work.
Congratulations, Rocco, and best of luck in your future endeavors.
Once again, congratulations, Rocco, on winning Student of the Month. I wish you the best of luck for the rest of the school year and all of your future endeavors.
Congratulations, Rocco. I have two more awards. Two more students to recognize this month. We have two Eagle Scout Award winners to be recognized. As a reminder to everyone in the audience and to the board, to earn your Eagle Scout requires the following accomplishments. You must earn 21 merit badges, including first aid, citizenship in the community, citizenship in the nation, citizenship in the world, communications, cooking, environmental science, personal fitness, camping, family life, personal management, emergency preparedness or life-saving, cycling, hiking, or swimming. You must also serve 6 months in a troop leadership position, take part in a Scoutmaster conference, and plan, develop, and give leadership to a service project for any religious organization or any other school or community organization, and successfully complete an Eagle Scout Board of Review. And tonight we celebrate two Eagle Scouts. Our first Eagle Scout is Jacob Cusco. Jacob, come on down. A round of applause for his family who's in attendance this evening. Jacob worked hard to make trash can holders for the Lacey Rail Trail behind Wawa and another set in Waretown. So his community service project was to improve the rail trail, keep it clean between us and Waretown. So congratulations, Jacob. Nice job on that. Congratulations, Jacob. Nice job. Keep up the good work. Our next Eagle Scout Award winner to be recognized this evening is Aiden White. Aiden, come on over. Continue the round of applause for his family this evening, who's here in attendance. Aiden also worked on the rail trail. Aiden worked and designed a new information kiosk for the trail at Forked River Mountain. A trail in Forked River Mountain that should open up this spring. So it's a brand new trail. Really? His kiosk was large enough where they had to load it onto a trailer, bring it down to the thing. It was quite a project. So again, this is information that hikers can use to learn about the trails and the mountain itself. So it's a very, very nice project as well. So congratulations, Aiden. Nice job. Thank you. All right, Dr. Pryor, that concludes my presentation for the evening.
All right, looking forward to seeing those projects. Another round of applause to our Eagle Scouts. All right, as we do every month, I always say behind every successful student is an amazing teacher that taught him or her. So I am very happy to announce our two staff members of the month. Our first is Denise Villanova, who is our cafeteria lead at Mill Pond. Is Denise with us tonight? Not here? Okay, we'll make sure she gets her certificate and make sure she watches her video. But let me just read a few things that her colleagues wrote about her. It was very extensive, so I shortened it a little bit. But what they say is that Denise is extremely motivated and enthusiastic and passes these qualities on to each of her staff members. She takes pride in the Lacey Township School District and especially Mill Pond. Her work ethic and cheery personality creates a pleasant environment for all staff and students. Denise has been in this district for 20 plus years and has shown her absolute love and dedication to this district. And for these reasons, Denise Villanova is very deserving of Staff Member of the Month for March. Congratulations. All right, and our second Staff Member of the Month is speech therapist at Mill Pond, Ashley Schmida. Is Ashley here tonight? I thought that was cool. You didn't think you were going to get away with sitting up there, right? All right, as Ashley makes her way down, again, a very extensive description of why, Ashley, you were nominated. I'm going to read a little snippet. Ashley has been nominated for this recognition because she is outstanding, hardworking, dedicated to students, motivated, and always supports students and teachers. She plays a huge role in preschool and kindergarten, attending meetings and supporting teachers and support staff who are in class with her. Ashley is very deserving of this recognition, and we congratulate her on behalf of the entire school district. Congratulations. And I think you have your own cheering corner up there, I see. Yes. All right. So don't go anywhere yet. As tradition, we have a few videos, right, Mr. Lytle? All right, here we go.
Hi, I'm Mrs. Donahue, and I'm so proud because I have a staff member of the month here at Mill Pond. We're going to go surprise Ashley Smitta. I can't wait. Follow me. A minute?
We do.
I wanted to say congratulations because you're Mill Pond staff member of the month. Yay!
That's crazy.
Thank you.
my name is Ms. DePalma. I'm a preschool teacher here at Mill Pond. I nominated Ashley Smita for Staff Member of the Month this month for a number of reasons. She is so passionate and dedicated to our students, especially our youngest learners, including the ones that have challenging behaviors, and it just doesn't go unnoticed how amazing and kind and good she is with them. In addition, I feel like sometimes the service providers go a little under the radar or, you know, don't get as much recognition because they don't have their own classroom. But here, it doesn't go unnoticed or underappreciated because, you know, I see her running from session to session, running from meeting to meeting, you know, speed walking from evaluation to meeting, and as well as being the sweeper at the end of the day and how much of a team player she is, you know, gathering all of the students and walking them down to the main office for dismissal. One thing I really admired most about her and kind of looked up to her and learned from her as a newer teacher and someone that's a little younger, just how she speaks to families in meetings and how kind and compassionate she is. And just like she's so very easy to speak to and listen to, and she's really very empathetic and just shows so much professionalism in IEP meetings and evaluations. And that's one thing I've really learned from her. And those are my reasons why I nominated her this month. Thank you for all you do, Ashley.
Hi, it's Joni Donahue again from Mill Pond. And
thank you. Congratulations. And congratulations to Ashley's family as well, who's here.
Hi, I'm Mrs. Donahue, and I'm so proud.
Oh, sorry about that, Mr. Lytle.
Oh, that's all right.
Hi, it's Joni Donahue again from Mill Pond, and I am excited because we're going to go surprise Denise Villanova. She's our lead in the cafeteria. She was nominated for Staff Member of the Month. Here we go. Follow me.
Hey, what can I do for you?
Good morning. Twinkle, twinkle, little star. And we just switched it.
Congratulations. Are you kidding me?
Email that we can nominate someone for Staff Member of the Month, I thought of Denise right away. I've been working with her for 6 years, and she's been nothing but amazing and caring and helpful, willing to work with others, willing to do whatever she needs to do to get the kids fed. And
so, yeah, I've been working with her for about 7 years, and same what Jen just said, that she's a great boss, she's an excellent employee, she's been in the district over 20 years, she does whatever she can for the kids and the staff, she's always trying to look for better ways to improve our service for everyone, and she was a no-brainer for Employee of the Month.
And we'll make sure Denise gets her certificate. Congratulations to both of you. All right, and as far as presentations go, I believe our last tonight is the Lacey Minute for March. Okay, here we go.
Thank you.
High School, Bennett Talbot.
Once again, thank you to Mr. Merman and his crew for putting together our Lacey Minutes. We are so appreciative. All right, we in a moment are going to introduce the tentative budget, and I suspect that some of our students have a lot of homework and maybe not the most exciting topic, so this would be a good time to run.
Congratulations.
Good job.
Good job. Remember Denise Spinello, his son was an Eagle Scout.
Oh, yeah?
Congratulations, nice job.
He did the signs.
Congratulations.
Congratulations.
On each end, he did the two of them.
Nice. Very nice.
Congratulations. Have a good night, guys.
Congratulations.
Congratulations.
Congratulations. Congratulations.
Good night.
Congratulations.
Okay. In a few minutes, Ms. Ormsby, Mr. Zielinski and I are going to be presenting the tentative budget for the 2024-2025 school year. If you've been following along, you know that our district is in a financial crisis, and there's really no other way to say it. We are in a financial crisis. Unfortunately, on February 27th, we learned that instead of a $1.3 million reduction, we instead got a $3.2 million state aid reduction, which we're going to talk about in terms of what that means for the budget build. Our community has been very, very vocal in reaching out to our state legislators, and we thank you for that. I have heard that the letters have been coming in fast and furious. The phone calls also have been going out. And, you know, that's what we've been saying, that we have to make sure that our voices are heard. Tomorrow, Ms. Ormsby and I are going to be traveling to Trenton along with Mr. Bond and Dr. Dowd to once again provide testimony. So it'll be the third time that we've been at the State House Annex to meet with the Senate Budget Appropriations Committee, the Senate Education Committee, so that we can talk about how S2 has hurt our district. And we will continue to do that because, as I've said many times verbally and in letters, our students deserve better, our teachers deserve better, and our entire school community deserves better. So with that, tonight, perhaps you have already seen in our budget workshops and
when we presented, after the budget workshop, that's right. So a lot of this is going to seem repetitive, but obviously we have new information. So, I know that we've been talking about S2 for a long time. Believe me, we are just as sick of talking about it as you are hearing about it. But we have to talk about it because it's not over. This is the final year of S2, and unfortunately, we do not know what the school funding formula is going to look like beyond it. But what you can see here is the impact that S2 has had on our district. Now, by the way, these numbers represent a nearly $14 million reduction in state aid. And at the inception of S2, what we were anticipating was a $6 million reduction over a six-year span. So we're now sitting at nearly $14 million. So to put this into perspective, our state aid back in the 2018-19 school year was sitting at about $20 million, and our state aid is a little over $7 million. So it's been cut more than half. And unfortunately, there is still a need to address a few other issues. So when we take into account the contractual responsibilities that rise above 2% in many areas, that is adding to our budget imbalance or our budget deficit. And when I say those two, they're really interchangeable. We're also talking about higher gasoline prices, increased insurance premiums, tuition increases that are outside of our local control, transportation cost increases, and just plain old inflation, which I know you're all aware of because we're all experiencing inflation in our own homes. After taking into consideration, and again, we're going to go over this in a little bit more detail, but after taking into consideration the most recent state aid reduction of $3.2 million, and the contractual obligations that we have, and all of the reductions that we have made so far, our budget is still sitting at a $6.9 million deficit or imbalance. And we're going to talk a little bit later about what that means to us and some of the discussions that our board has had, along with the discussions that we have had with our county office. So our county office is made up of the county superintendent and a county business administrator. Her name is Cindy. We've been talking to her almost every single day because when we get to this point, we have to go in some different directions. So before we get into that, I'm gonna ask Ms. Ormsby to just go over some of the slides to just acquaint you with our revenue, our appropriations, and our tax levy.
First, we're going to talk about the reductions that we've already made to the budget. So first, we're able to make a few prepayments in this year's budget to alleviate next year's budget, which is some bus leases and some terminal leave payments. And this is all of the reductions that we're making in next year's budget. So we're going to be reducing 26 certificated positions, which includes 25 non-tenured positions, 5 tenured positions, a full-time position through attrition, which basically means they're retiring, a full-time para, a guidance position, I'm sorry, a part-time para, 5 duty and lunch aid positions, 6 long-term substitute positions, summer guidance, maintenance and ground substitutes and overtime, projected cost of health insurance, which that's related to the positions that we're cutting, Social Security, which is also related to the positions we're cutting, reductions in special ed professional services. Now, that has to do with BCBA and RBT services, which we're able to reduce that based because we've hired another BCBA. We were able to reduce the telephone costs. That was more because I had put in an estimated cost, and when I did some more analysis on it, I was able to reduce that cost. Instructional supplies, non-instructional supplies. Now that number is so large because we had actually put in replacement of Chromebooks, replacement of laptops that are 5 to 7 years old, but we can't replace them at this point. Some additional special education costs, which these costs are nursing services, ESY salaries, speech supplies, and some other supplies. These are being cut after our special services director did, again, some further analysis after he originally budgeted and found that we could reduce those expenses a little bit. Some professional development, we're reducing. The contracted services, we had initially budgeted for trash services, and the town came in and said that they would pay for the trash services for us for next year. We're reducing co-curriculars again, courtesy busing, which this includes subscription busing, the late bus, weekend busing, and this, the subscription busing. Tuition, that was again some further analysis that our special services director did after we had put in the initial budget that we were able to reduce, and then athletics.
So let me add to the bottom of this slide, you can see the number there is 6.5. So even before learning what our state aid reduction would be, or what our state aid figure would be, we cut $6.5 million out of our budget. And Mr. Ormsby just went through the list of how we got here. And I have to say that this was a grueling task. Mr. Zielinski can certainly speak to that. We've had to bring our administrative team together over and over and over again to make decisions on what these reductions would be. And, you know, I mentioned this last month. Ms. Ormsby mentioned 26 staff reductions, several of them being tenure. That's important for me to talk about right now, and I'll talk about it again. When we have to reduce tenured staff, there is a very specific process by which we do that, because that is based on the tenure law, and it's based on certification and the areas that need to be reduced. And we also take into consideration that we did just expand our preschool program. In fact, that was the meeting that happened right before today's board meeting. So, you know, when I get letters and emails and we get phone calls and we get pleas from the community, you know, please save this teacher and you know, get rid of this teacher over that teacher. That's not the way it works. We don't sit in a room and say, well, we're going to eliminate this teacher and we're going to reduce this teacher. That, when we get to the tenure piece of this, that is based on the tenure law. And sometimes our hands are forced. We have to make decisions based on that law. So I just wanted to make that distinction, because the difference between a reduction in force for a non-tenured teacher is very different than a reduction for a tenured teacher. And I would be happy to answer any questions that anybody has. Just please call my office, and I can go over that with you in more detail. Mr. Zielinski can, and we can point you in the right direction if we don't have a specific answer.
And just I'd like to note that, because you hit on it already, but if you go back a slide, these reductions are pre our announcement from the state of New Jersey about our further cuts in state aid. These cuts will result in elementary class sizes 28 to 34 or so. All high school, middle school classes will likely push the 30 number, and there will be cuts to some programs. So there'll be cuts of athletics, cuts to co-curricular, and cuts to regular curricular programs. All special education classes will be pushed up to the max number, all because of these draconian cuts by the state.
And so if you go to the next slide, and we're going to be talking about this in a little bit more detail, even after all of those reductions and the effects of these reductions on our schools, we're still sitting at a near $7 million imbalance or deficit, which again, we're going to go into detail.
So here's our our total tentative budget. So the total operating budget is $71,226,468. The grants and entitlements budget is $7,885,167. And the debt service budget is $3,302,700. So I want to point out that the operating budget isn't much different from last year. And I want to remind everybody of what the cuts were to get to this year. We've cut 102 staff in the past 7 years, 6 years to get here. We realigned our district to make efficiencies and to consolidate services to get here now. We can't go much further than what we've done to get here. So it's why you don't see much of a difference. We're really at rock bottom. We can't go any further. We have to continue to fight for this district to keep us where we're at. We have to keep fighting. So this is just more detail on the grants budget. ESEA is our title funds. We're always recommended to only budget about 85% of the current year's budget, because we never know exactly what the state's going to fund us in the title grants. So that's why it's only $720,000, when you can see in the current year we've got about $1 million in the title grants. IDEA, same thing, we budget only 85%. PEA, that's our preschool funding. It's inclusive of a general fund portion. So when you see that in this year, or for next year, it's $5,659,000, our actual allocation from the state is only $4.5 million, but we have to put in a little over $1 million from the general fund to fund the special ed portion. So that's what that note is for. Where in the current year, that 3.3, that's only the state portion. That doesn't include the general fund portion.
And before you go on to the ESSER, I just want to point out, because a lot of the questions have been coming in, because if the district is in such a crisis, why are we running this preschool program? So the answer to that is very simple. The preschool expansion program is paying for itself, and those monies are completely separate from the operating budget, completely separate. So when people say, well, you just have to get rid of it, why would we get rid of a program that is offering an extremely valuable preschool experience for 250 students and growing, and a program that's paying for itself? Why would we not offer preschool that these are our students, and then they're ready to move into kindergarten and then beyond? So that would be my response.
Well, additionally, too, what has to also is lost in the sauce a little bit is that because of how the preschool expansion aid works, it actually relieves the general budget by almost $1 million.
More than that.
Because we pay for salaries that would still exist without PEA with PEA funding, because it's an allowable expense. So, and I thought it was less, but we looked at it the other day. We believe that it's actually relieving the general budget by $1 million. So we'd be not 6 point in the hole, we'd be 7 point in the hole without PEA. Additionally, if you choose to walk around Milpon, any improvements that are happening at Milpon are on the backs of PEA, which benefits our kindergartners and the rest of the population in that building as well. We'll be getting money. Brand new playground is getting installed in the next month or so. Lots of things. We need another playground next year. All sorts of things like that. So I just don't want that lost in the sauce.
So then we move on to ESSER. ESSER is the funds that we started receiving during the COVID, the pandemic. So ESSER 1 expired 2 years ago. ESSER 2 expired this past September. ESSER 3 expires this September. So that's why you only see a small amount going into next year's budget. That'll really just be any small amount of rollover money that we're going to use in the summer for the summer enrichment program.
Correct, because we had last summer of it funded through that.
Right.
We have additional funding next year, we'll try to do it again.
Yeah.
But that's not going to
happen. And by the way, this is what also has added to our budget deficit, the fact that the ESSER monies expired.
Right. And then local and other. So that's small local grants that we get, scholarships, and clubs. So now the operating budget. So this is how the revenue is broken down in the operating budget. So you have the property tax levy of $54,256,788. So you can see that's going up exactly 2% from this year to next year. The categorical state aid, that's our state aid. So you can see that the decrease of the $3.2 million, which is 30% of our state aid. Extraordinary aid, that goes up a little bit. Our fund balance allocation and excess surplus. So this is something that we talk about every year. Fund balance is not something that we like to use in balancing a budget. Fund balance is something, it's like your savings account. You know, try to keep your savings, you try not to use it. But unfortunately, we've had to use it. I'll show in another slide the breakdown. We're using about 700,000 of our fund balance. Again, not something we want to do, but we have to. Unfortunately, we are down to the point where, so as a school district, we're allowed to keep 2% of our expenditures in fund balance. We are down to 1.4%. It's bad. It's very bad. But again, we don't have a choice at this point. Excess surplus, that's something that we generate in the prior year. So that's from 22-23 school year. We were only able to generate a little over 300,000 from that school year. So we don't have much excess surplus to utilize in this school year. September question slash state loan. That is our deficit that we're talking about. We're going to talk a little bit more about that in a future slide as to what exactly that all means. And then miscellaneous revenue, that's just that miscellaneous revenue that we get from tuition. Like last year, we got money from the town. We're hoping that we can get money from the town again. So that's just all that is. Here's the calculation of the property tax levy. So you see the this year's property tax levy, the 2% increase, what it gets us to this year's next year's tax levy, and then the debt service property tax levy. That's actually a decrease because the debt service is continually going down. And then the total property tax levy, which is $56,998,761, so the net increase is only 1.75%. Here's a breakdown of our state aid. It's broken down into these different categories. You have special education aid, equalization aid, security aid, and transportation aid. I have equalization aid highlighted in red. That is the aid that they continue to cut. The other aids have been static the past few years. Those are always the same amount. The chart on the bottom, you can see where in 18-19 we got $20,970,000 of state aid, where now we're getting $7 million.
And that has a cumulative impact. I know that slide is kind of hard to see. This presentation will be posted on our website. But when you take a look at that bottom line number, you can start to see that these continuous reductions having a very, very bad impact on our district. And again, we're going to highlight that a little bit more later on.
Here's the breakdown of the fund balance. So you can see a $703,000 is what we're using out of our budgeted fund balance to balance the budget. And then $315,000 is the excess surplus from 22-23. Here's some information on per pupil cost. We're projecting, and it's really just an estimate, approximately 3,934 students for next year. That's inclusive of the preschool. So our budgetary per pupil cost is $17,457. That's $1,573 below the 22-23 statewide median of $19,000. And then our admin per pupil cost is $1,306, which is 1269, which is 2,557. That's right, I'm sorry, that's the actual regional limit, 2,575. So it's 1,200 below that. So we are the sixth lowest for admin costs for large K through 12 districts in the state.
So some might say that we're running a very efficient school district, and I think the board will agree we are. We are running a very efficient school district financially, which when people ask me, well then why is the state continually cutting our state aid? That's a great question, and that's why we've been going to try and testify, because seemingly it doesn't make sense. What we can say, and what we do know, and I was at a presentation last night with Mrs. Claus, is the fact that our enrollment has declined over the last 10 years. That is a fact. It has declined. However, for the past 3 to 5 years, our enrollment has been fairly steady, fairly flatlined, I should say. And now with the increase of preschool, it's actually growing. We also do know that there's a lot of building going on in Lacey, and how many students are going to be coming to us, obviously, is unknown. Now, when Cornerstone first went up, the first two phases of Cornerstone, we were expecting a big influx of students. However, what we found is many of the families that moved into Cornerstone 1 and 2 were already our families, so we didn't see that increase in population. However, we don't know if that's going to continue to be the case as the building continues in Lacey. So if I were to say this succinctly, the state is reducing our state aid faster than we can make up in property tax increases because of the 2% cap. You saw that in the slide a few slides ago. We are limited to a 2% cap. We're going to talk about that again a little bit later as an opportunity that is available to us to surpass that.
All right, our appropriations. So this is where the categories where we're going to spend the money. I'm not going to go through each category, but you can see the breakdown here of how we'll spend the money in the 24-25 budget. And we're going to go through property taxes again. There's two components to the property taxes, the operating budget and then the debt service budget. This is just how it's calculated. You take your total current taxes divided by your current assessment valuation times 100 to get your tax rate. So the total current assessed valuation is $4,029,146,600 to come up with 1.415 as the school tax rate for 24. So the average house value for 24 is $287,000. So your school taxes would be about $4,061. So the per month household increase would be about $5.71.
I have a question real quick. I think it was on the last line. What is the tax penny when they ask what's the increase with the, what is that the 1.45?
No, that's the tax rate. The 1.415. That's the school tax rate.
Tax rate 1. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So for the average assessed home, which is $287,000. The per month tax increase, this is the 2% cap, would be $5.71.
Okay.
Obviously lower, the assessment is lower, higher, the assessment is higher for the whole. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm. Okay.
As was whispered over here, that's $60.
Correct.
A little over $60.
Yes. Yep. But mind you, we
doesn't include the shortfall.
We do not currently have the provision to exceed that because of the 2% cap. All right, so as I mentioned earlier, I'm going to summarize and then we're going to talk about next steps. So this is a slide that you've already seen. These were our part one reductions. We've already talked about these. This is how we got to the budget imbalance of 6.9 million. So I'm not going to go through it again. We already know that we're talking about 26 teachers, 21 non-tenured, 5 tenured, support staff, reductions to athletics, reductions to the co-curricular budgets, academic supports for students who need extra help, elimination of educationally valuable field trips, reduction of elective class offerings at the middle school and high school, and the elimination of courtesy busing. You know, in an earlier slide, you saw that some of those reductions included our counseling and support staff. Given how I opened this meeting, the one thing that I've said over and over again is that is the last thing the Lacey Township School District should be reducing is counseling and support staff. The absolute last, among many other things. But here we are. So then the next logical question is, the question is, do we reduce the budget by $6.9 million to correct that imbalance? The board and I and Sharon and Will and the rest of the administration have talked about the answer to that question. That question is no, we don't. Why? Because we have nowhere else to cut. Because those cuts, those reductions are ugly and no longer give us the opportunity to offer what's called a T&E, which is constitutionally required, stands for thorough and efficient education. But if we had to do it,
before you switch sides, if you go back to that slide.
I didn't get there yet.
The one you were just on?
Yes.
Like just to give some focus, because I know some of our team is here, Michelle Mallory in the back here. As hard as we worked to get to this, it's so ugly, I've got nobody happy. And that's part of this slot. But to go lower than this, we believe we can't function. And that's a belief in enrollment, a belief in programs, a belief in T&E, like you said. That's this slot. That's already what we've got, which is this ugly for everybody. So that's where we are, and now you're gonna go further.
Right. No, we're not.
Well, we're not, right.
So then we ask the question, now what? What do we do now? So folks, this is what it looks like. If we were to reduce this budget another $6.9 million, we're talking about 57 additional staff reductions, which is inclusive of salary and benefits, bringing our total staff reduction to 96 for just 24-25 alone. Our overall staff reduction since the inception of S2, a staggering 198. That is absolutely going to drive our class sizes into the upper 40s across all grades 1 through 12. Upper 40s. That is not a thorough and efficient education. Further reductions to custodial support, counseling, clerical, and administrative staff has to happen. Pay to participate for all athletic programs, meaning we are no longer offering free or what our students are entitled to athletics. It's pay to participate, no doubt. The elimination of all co-curricular activities. No science clubs, no math club, no proud pause, the list goes on. And then additional reductions to all repair and maintenance accounts by 25%, which results in us only being able to do emergency repairs, meaning there's no preventative maintenance. And I've said this time and time again, if you ever come to this high school after a nor'easter, it's embarrassing, the amount of leaks, and that's just here. So again, this is no longer a thorough and efficient education. We will not do this. We can't do this. So, what does that mean? It means that we are considering, and we've discussed, a September public question. So what does that mean to our community? What it means is that this is a process, first, that needs to be developed by our Board of Education, and then approved by the county and the New Jersey Department of Education. Now, I have to be honest, this is a route that is new to us. We thought that we were going to have to wait until November. Turns out that we do not. September 17th would be the date where, and I'm going to read it, we would ask the Lacey Township Board of Education is seeking an approval from the district's legal voters to raise an additional to be determined amount of money, which is why it says that, for the 24-25 school year as permitted under 18A, which is the statute.
And that approval of these taxes will result in a permanent increase in the district's tax levy. Now, that number to be determined is something that the board and us will have to develop, because we will then have a responsibility to let every single taxpayer in Lacey know what that impact would be. So the number that would change is the number that we showed you earlier. The $5.71 a month would therefore increase. And we would then outline for our taxpayers and our entire community what is it that we would be either restoring or maintaining with this public question. Good? Okay. So the next logical question, and I hope you're all asking it to yourselves, is what happens if the special question is voted down negatively? It doesn't pass. What happens if it doesn't pass? Unfortunately, and we had this conversation with our county business administrator, is a state loan. It means that we will have to be forced to take out a state loan to fix our budget imbalance. Yes.
Mm-hmm. So let's say, hypothetically, it's not passed, and we don't want to do a state loan. What would happen to the district?
We would go back to the last slide.
Go back to our 56 cuts.
Right. But at that point, you said we wouldn't be, I forgot the exact word.
They're unefficient.
They're inefficient.
So would the state come in anyway and take us over because we weren't up to standards?
I can't answer that. I mean, that's a hypothetical, because, you know, there's no clear definition of how they define a thorough and efficient education, and it's technically up to us. But we believe that having 40 students in any class is not a thorough and efficient education. So to get back to your original question, if the question doesn't pass and we don't want a state loan, then that this is what we're looking at. We have no choice. And we had a conversation with our county business administrator. It may be that the state loan would be imposed upon us.
Meaning that we have to take it?
Yes.
They force you to take a loan?
Like they... If we can't produce a balanced budget, then yes, we hypothetically could.
So here's the next question. So if we can't, if we have to take a loan out and we can't, how do we pay back a loan that we can't afford?
You don't. It keeps on going.
So every year we'll have to take out a loan.
Yep. So we're but then we'll be such in a hole. What happens next?
So we never
the
get
state
out.
Comes in and just takes. They, eventually, they it's like a foreclosure on a house. If you keep taking yes. loans out on it,
we'll be bankrupt.
You do
Lakewood
not own
started at $5 million loan. They're up to 100 and now. Change.
Right. So let me say a couple of things about that.
Yeah.
Nobody, not the board, not us. Nobody is jumping up and down and saying yes, give us a loan. That is the last thing we want to do. Which is why we had a conversation about a September public question. Now, there are a few unknowns, and that is that we are hoping that the testimony that we've been providing, not just us, by the way, but other S2 districts that have been impacted heavily, and they're out there, have been appealing to the governor and the legislators about the inequity of this. And last year, around this time, maybe a little bit later, we did learn that we did receive, or districts received 66% of the state aid cuts back. So our reduction was $4 million. We got back $2.6 million, and our reduction was $1.3 million. So if that happens, if we learn that monies are restored, then all of these numbers are going to change. Obviously, if, let's just make this up for a moment, let's just say that $3.2 million is restored to us, it changes the 6.9 imbalance, which then changes the public question. And then if we are able to raise funds via taxes through the special question, then there's no longer a need for a loan. Does that make sense?
Yeah, it makes sense. I just want to say that the board does not want to do a loan. And the taxpayers that have been coming to me, I don't know if they'd be coming to other board members, but they don't want a loan. So we're hoping that the governor gives us some money back. There's also a bill that hopefully will pass so we can go above the 2% cap, which they're going tomorrow to testify. That should help. But in the end, we don't want to take a loan because then they come in and they take over.
Everything.
So, and they can cut whatever they want to. They can override the board. They can override Dr. Pereira. They can override Ms. Ornsby. So we're in a very bad spot. But this is where we are. So we're hoping we get some money back. Again, we don't want to take a loan. So I don't know. Go ahead. Well, we do have a letter campaign, if I can just touch on it real quick.
Yes.
To help. So with the emails and everything that everyone's been doing with the governor, the school started a letter campaign. If you have an organization that we could speak to, last night we went to Seabreeze Community. There was another club we went to. We probably got 250 in a week letters. And basically, it's just a permission slip, and I have some here if you guys didn't send your emails in yet. And it just allows the school, we have people here that will input your information and send letters to all the committees. So if you know of any community gatherings, we would love to come and just present what's going on, just so we can keep pushing forward. So that's just another thing that we can do to help with this situation.
And when we have the question, we will definitely put on there, if this isn't approved, this is what's going to happen. Like, they
we
need
will.
To see that, because there's a lot of, there's people that aren't going to even know this, no matter how many times
oh,
you talk
they'll
about
know
it.
It. They will
so
know
you
it.
Really want to see it on the, they need to see if this is not approved, then the class size could go to 40.
Yes.
They need
we will
to
make
see
that,
that
very clear. Yeah.
May I ask a question?
No.
The county just reduced their tax rate by 2 cents due to the revalue of Palms River, so they got increased revenue. Have you asked the township of Lacey if they have any plans to do a revalue here, because that would automatically increase your property?
The finance committee of the board has met with the township committee, so they're well aware of where we are with all of this.
So they didn't say if they
did not.
So I have a question. We're talking about class size. Now
class
I'm an older guy. I'm an older guy here on the board. And I grew up where class sizes were a lot larger than they are today. And I think a lot of it had to do with, we didn't move class to class. The teachers came to our class, so I guess it was a little bit more controllable back then. But if we, can we stagger that? Like, keep things normal in, say, K through 4, and then start staggering that class number up? Because if we look at high school, I mean, high school, we're prepping, hopefully, prepping kids for the next stage in their life. And some of those students, the next stage of their life is college, universities. And if you go into a lecture hall, mm-hmm. there's more than 20 kids in a classroom.
It's
about 40, 50, 60 in the classroom. So I'm not advocating to say, let's just put 40 kids in every classroom, because, yeah, I can understand how it would be hard having 40 first graders in your classroom. But what I'm saying, that there could be, if it sounds logical, a benefit to increasing that, at least in high school, to get that feeling of what a college life is like. However, we really don't have the classrooms then to really make that work in an efficient manner where everybody's focused on the classroom. Not everybody's sitting next to each other, and all of a sudden this starts to happen and that starts to happen. So I don't know. The loan idea scares the living daylights out of me, because it's a rabbit hole. It's we're never going to get out of it. And I'll take the same tone as my peers here. I'm reaching out to the community and asking for help. It may look like, I've been a board member, this is my third year, and it may look like a mismanagement of funds, because that's some of the things we do here, but it hasn't. And I think I have a reputation that when I think something's not right on this dais, I'll call it out. And what we're asking for here is, I'm not asking you guys to start writing checks and, you know, anonymously drop them in the mailbox to us. But what I'm asking for is an understanding, an opportunity to pull through this together, to come up with ideas on how we make this work. And if it's something as simple as writing letters to the legislator, please do it. If it's something as simple as making a phone call, just to make noise. Mm-hmm. I mean, the squeaky wheel, right? We have to do something. I can assure you that the Finance Committee has done more than one meeting a month when we got news of this.
Yeah.
OK? Okay, we've been sitting almost every other week for more than a half hour. We made a joke the other day, you know, we said to Kim, why don't you just write a check and we'll be done, you know? And we don't have that. We don't have that luxury. So what I'm asking for you, if you have an idea, if you look at these numbers and you have an idea and you look at our district and you say, you know what if we did this? I'm sure no one's going to dismiss you. As long as there's logical sense behind it, there's fact-finding behind it, it makes sense, and it helps everyone. And that's what we're asking for here. Class sizes at 40, you know, the old school Sal and me says, yeah, it's not a big deal. But knowing the way the world is today, it's a big deal. It's a big deal. So on that cue, I'm done.
Would you have something to say?
Absolutely, that's always an option.
But it's not for salaries, right,
Dad? It probably could not be.
I don't think we can.
Cannot be for
you
salaries.
You can't do fundraising for salaries.
Yeah.
For stipends or salaries, you can. But if we know a club's getting cut from a school, as parents and community, we can come together and fundraise, maybe to get
them
back.
And make a donation for books, and then
fund. Sure.
I mean, are there ways we can do that?
There are.
I mean, we did talk about that in finance to not, I mean, right now it's just freshman sports that are being cut and multiple clubs, but it's not off the table to fundraise to get the kids to participate. So, and I'm sure Dr. Pereira is going to talk about that. Well, she did the pay to play too. So,
that would be something too if somebody, a rep, can come to one of our PTA meetings and
yeah, we'll be
just,
doing
just,
that.
We've
talked about this too, but just keep in mind, like, and these are awesome, but you're, and I just kind of mentioned it here to Cameron, like, you're kind of picking away. This is $7 million.
This is,
you know, yes, we want everything funded by the state of New Jersey like they should. Like, that's our bottom line.
Yeah, but they're not. But they're not right now. We have community members willing to lend a hand, and to dismiss it as we want the whole thing, you know. If you can chip away at it. Are you kidding me? I mean,
we're going to have a public budget meeting where we can discuss all this. So we're going to have an open public budget meeting. But I can tell you one thing. As board president, there's a song out there from Jason Aldean. Try that on a small town. I refuse to give this district up to the state of New Jersey. I'm telling you right now. And the majority of us do, too. They come in. They take over. They have their own comptroller. That controls her or finances. That can override the board on our elections. Whatever we vote on here tonight, they say, you know what? Nope, that's not happening. You owe us $5 million.
And just as an example of that, let's say we want to bring back freshman sports. You know, we got a donation from the town or wherever. We can't do that without the state's approval if we take that loan. So they're going to be micromanaging our district. Mm-hmm. And think about your property, your houses. The value of your houses when the school district is being run by the state, is someone going to want to come and live in Lacey?
No.
So it's a big snowball effect. I know you've reached out, you've gone to Trenton. Any good word about any of that?
About the state loan?
Not the state loan. About
no, there's no good word on the state loan.
I'm sorry, about what, Mrs. Walker?
I know you've been to Trenton. Mm-hmm. Are there any like rumors going around that maybe someone is trying to work for us to get our money back?
Yes. So, like I said, I have been working, we all have been working with other S2 districts who have just been as noisy as we have been. And we are hearing that there is perhaps a little bit of movement. We just don't know what that is, which is why Mr. Peters makes a good point that by the time we have our budget workshop and by the time we are required to present the final budget, which is April 30th, we may have a lot more information that's going to change all of this. In the meantime, we are going to continue to get out to different groups, like Mrs. Claus said. Last night we were at Seabreeze. We will talk to all of the PTAs. I'm thinking about bringing all the PTA presidents together and have them sit in one room so that they can then go back and disseminate. So I do believe that our voices are being heard
And I do believe that different people are now part of the conversation that perhaps were not part of the conversation before.
Well, that's good news.
Yeah, it is good news.
How can they say what a thorough, what is it?
Thorough and efficient.
An efficient education is if there's no limit on class sizes. They can't.
That's a great question.
So they really can't. So what is it? Pre-K is 15, kindergarten is 25. So really anything over that, we can do.
Oh,
so if we
it.
Can get our budget down, if they give us money, if the taxes, if we can go over the 2%, if all this falls into place, we need to do our best to cut, unfortunately, more before we ask the community to take a loan. Everything. Mm-hmm. Go 100% pay to play or whatever we have to do. Unfortunately, more staff, but that's where we need to be. So just keep making noise. That's really all we can do is just keep making noise. So if anybody here did not sign this paper, I'm going to ask you to not leave until I give you some copies that you can sign real quick. And, you know, we'll just keep pushing at that.
Okay. Would there be a deadline date that we would know?
We don't.
I know we're talking the state, and anything can happen, but do they have, if we were going to get any funding back, do you think there's, do you have any date in mind that we'd know by? Because, I mean, they're asking us to do, you're doing all this stuff, and like, let's say you put the question out there, it does get approved, they give you money, but like, they just...
None.
Yeah, that's
None.
Kind of insane.
No, but what we have been doing is when we're testifying, we're telling them, we kind of need to know by mid-April, because we're required to provide a final budget by April 30th. So that would be the time. And ideally, that would be the best time. Yeah.
Okay.
Well, the best time would have been
yeah,
when they
I
announced
understand.
Dating
okay.
originally, but.
Dr. Pereira.
Yes.
Two parts, actually. Had to put you on the spot, Ms. Ormsby, but do you know the total ESSER monies that we got? 6 million, 9 million, 12 million, ballpark?
From inception?
Yeah.
It's been big.
Not holding you to it. It's
6 to 8 million.
Okay. Since 21. Right? So they've
right,
taken.
Since the start of the pandemic.
Right.
Right.
So they've taken over the last 3 years. What we received in ESSER money, essentially,
mm-hmm.
right?
ESSER has kind of saved us.
So, if we approve this tonight, it's still a working document. Something has to be approved by the end of April.
Right.
What happens come the end of April? Are still not balanced, but the question isn't until September. What happens in between there?
Great question. We submit the budget with an imbalance because
okay.
the state knows that we're going to ask the public question.
Okay.
And so we would be technically in a holding pattern until that happens, and then the outcome of that.
Well, unfortunately,
so,
we let the cat out of the bag announcing the state that we're going to ask that question, and they're going to say, oh, we're not going to give them money back. Maybe they'll pass in September. You know what I'm saying? They might say, why give them money? They're going to let's wait till September and see what happens in September. If the taxpayers don't pass it, then maybe we'll give them some money.
I just don't want to.
So we wait until September, and if this doesn't pass, we have no time to go back to try to make any of these cuts. Like, even if it was a $2 million loan instead of a $7
million. Mm-hmm. I'm certain
right?
that the requirement would be that we'd have to go back to the drawing board and make those reductions somehow. Or, and you make a valid point, which is why I'm fairly certain, and I'm not going to speak for our county BA, which is why she said the loan would not be an option. Because at that point, we won't be able to balance the budget and make those reductions. If the question doesn't go through.
So they won't give us 2 weeks, 3 weeks, whatever it is to...
I don't know. You're asking me questions I don't
no,
have
I know.
The answer
just
to just yet.
Putting
yeah.
it out in general.
Yeah.
So shouldn't we...
All good questions, though, and all questions that we are going to be asking
right.
so that we are very informed before presenting this to the public.
Shouldn't we then prepare at the end of April
for the cuts, and then if the loan passes, then filter them back in, because that's what we were going to do for the November question, but now it's September. So shouldn't we make those cuts now and then hopefully bring them back in September?
All those cuts to make 40?
Well, to make the budget, right? Well, let's hope we get 2-3 million back.
Right, so that's why I think asking these questions right now, I mean, we're just talking hypotheticals, and to try to answer what we don't know is a little bit of a slippery slope.
I just don't want to start the school year and then all of a sudden we need to cut another 40 teachers and then the kids are disrupted. That's my point. So to prepare before September, hopefully it'll pass, then we can add more, but I don't want September to come and all of a sudden now kids are moving their classes.
Right,
because
nobody
wants
that.
The teacher's gone.
Okay, right. Let's save this for our budget.
Budget workshop. Okay. Yeah, so just a couple more slides. Next steps. So we have some important dates here. We've already talked about most of them. March 20th, which is tomorrow, is a deadline for the submission of the tentative budget to our executive county superintendent. Continue to explore opportunities to increase revenue. Wait to hear what is coming out of Trenton. Continue to explore opportunities to decrease appropriations. April 30th is our public hearing on an adoption of the final budget. And then May 14th is a deadline for the submission of the final budget. And we are hoping that we get a lot more information before that happens. The presentation that we just shared tonight is going to be on our website. If there are any questions after tonight, again, like everything, we encourage you to call us. We would be more than happy to answer questions as it relates to the budget. All right.
Good.
Thank you.
Next, we're going to move on to public comment. An audience member wishing to make a comment will raise his or her hand when called upon. State their name, address, or affiliation and attention to make a statement. Comments will be addressed to the board president. Comments will be made one issue at a time. Comments will be limited to 5 minutes. No audience member shall be recognized twice until who have wished commented have been recognized. This portion of the meeting is for public comments only. There is no questions to be answered. The purpose of this board meeting is to perform business in public. Everyone is entitled to a public comment. If there is a question for the board, there is an established chain of command to follow. Do we have anyone under public comment? Anyone? Okay. Please state your name and address, please.
Allison Hollister, Forked River. Just want to touch base on this budget crisis that we're having. Talking about up to 28 to 35 students in a classroom, possibly more if things don't get passed. Something to think about is maybe going to a period 1-8 schedule rather than having continuous the block schedule in the middle school and the high school. 42-minute periods instead of cramming 85 minutes where kids are being lost due to a high number of classes. 5 minutes in between. That is beneficial to the students' mental health. I don't know what to say, really. I'm in shock. I'm in awe. I'm in disbelief. I've sent letters. I've made phone calls. We should be calling the news stations. We should be picketing outside as parents, as teachers, as board members, and as just a community. Show, not just by letters, not just by phone calls, show them what they're doing to our kids. Not us, our kids. Their mental health is so important right now, especially what our district is dealing with right now. The teachers, their mental health as well, with these class sizes probably going up. You know, it's not easy to sit in the classroom of not just 20 kids. It's not easy to sit in the classroom with less than that. You know, it's hard for them as well, going back and forth in between classes and dealing with, you know, behavior issues, non-behavior issues, low-level scoring, low-level learners, you know, and trying to help them as well as help our other learners as well. You're talking about kids with special needs in these classes as well that are being lost in the transition. who may not be able to handle all this, the anxiety, depression, all this stuff is on these kids, and what are we doing? We're failing them, and it's really, really sad. I stood here 2 years ago and talked to you guys, former board members, about the mental health of our kids. I was at Ocean County College when a student jumped off the building and tried to commit suicide. I talked to you about that. I said, what are we doing? What is our district doing to help promote mental health? And some of you said, oh, we'll look into it. Now here we are almost 2 years later, and we lost two students to suicide. Something's got to give. And we need to be promoting as a community to get out there and do something about it. Our school is losing money. Our kids are losing educational activities after school. No clubs, no sports, no, you know, drama, no band, no this, no that. Like, what are we doing to them?
It's not, man, I'm not.
No, no, I'm not saying it's you. I'm not directed at you. I'm not directed at any of you. Please, I'm just.
This is not the board doing this.
No, and I'm. It's not directed.
I'm sorry to interrupt you, but it's.
It's not directed at you.
Okay, thank you.
It's just directed in general that we all need to do something about it, because who's hurting the most is our children. Absolutely. They go to school, they deal with this. If there's no clubs next year, what kind of mental health is that for them? There's no outlets in this community at all. There's no, I remember going Friday nights, coffee houses, teen nights. There's nothing in this town on a Friday or Saturday night for these children to do. But yet everybody sits on their computers behind a screen and complains when cars are burglarized, when there's something vandalized. Well, let's get out as a community and do something about it. It's about time. You know, our children have experienced so much this year, and we have experienced. We're the ones sitting watching our kids cry, our kids weep for their peers. We need to do something, and that's all I have to say.
Thank you for your comments. Anybody else? Public comment? Please state your name and address.
Rachel Gray, 527 Elwood Street, Forked River. I'm coming before the board because I have problems with my children in the community. I will start off by saying my 17-year-old, he started kindergarten not doing well. Like other, he liked projects, he didn't like to learn. I kept him back, I kept him into T1. Fast forward to his junior year now, he is failing every subject. Not because he can't do it, because he can do it. I made a big mistake keeping him back. I went into the school for an IEP meeting. The social worker, in his case, called him down. I said, get your butt back to class. You don't deserve being in an IEP meeting. He looked at me and laughed. As a social worker overtalked me and said, it's his right to be here. I said, get your butt back to class. And he laughed again. She overspoke me, as I told her she is not his mother, and said, when you're 18, I will have the meeting with you. He will be 18 in May. He wants to be a Marine. He wants to go into the Marines. He's a junior. I want to get him into the Marines as fast as humanly possible. Unfortunately, last year, he was supposed to take the ASFAB test. Not one of those social workers called him down to take it. There was four students. It was too hard for the social workers to call my son down. So he missed that opportunity. This year, he signed up to take the ASFAB test in April. I don't know the exact date, but he will be down there taking it. After this happened, I met with Mr. King. I went right to his office, and we spoke about my son and how he could achieve his final year here. We came up with a plan. I wrote Mr. King. I wrote the social worker. I wrote Dr. Prepare in an email. I would like her removed immediately from my son's case. I'd like this to be addressed as soon as possible. So So next, I'd like to say that I had 5 17-year-old kids at my front, at my desk, at my kitchen table. They all had a job application to work at a local store or community purse place in here. Not one of those kids could fill out a job application correctly. All misspelled, all lowercase, and it was sickening. I sat down with the kids, I showed them how to do it, and I was embarrassed. What happened to the school that I went to? Next, I'd like to address my other son, who is in second grade. He has problems. He was adopted. He has ADHD. I have an IEP for him as well. He can't add. He can't subtract. He can't write his alphabet correctly. And this is second grade. I got him at 12 months. He couldn't talk. At 2.5 years, he tested out of early intervention. And at 2.5 years, he was denied for the early preschool program here, and I was proud. At 7 years old, he could talk your ear off. He could sit here at this whole meeting, quiet as a mouse, next to me and my husband. 3 adult teachers in his class can't control him. This week alone, he conned 5 teachers. He said that he didn't eat breakfast. They called me 5 times. My son is a perfect angel when he's around me and my husband in our home. He's not so much at school. I don't know why teachers cannot control him. I don't know what to do. I didn't know that he couldn't add or subtract, and he is moving forward. The teacher is sending homework that he can't do, and there's no wonder why. Because he doesn't know how to add or subtract. He doesn't know the basics. This is what, and I'm glad I went after that last person. This is what's the problem in our community. Excuse me, 1 second. Oh. So I sat outside the school and waiting for my son to get out of high school. There was not one happy kid that came out of those doors. Everybody looking down at their phone, nobody laughing, nobody smiling.
Ma'am, we have a 5-minute limit.
I'm almost done.
But we're not gonna end you. If you're almost done, a little bit, just finish. But if not, you can have a seat, let somebody else come back and finish more, we'll come back.
Nobody was, no noise, no conversations, everybody is miserable. The students don't know how to conversate with each other. They don't know how to look each other in the eyes. They don't know how to have a conversation back and forth. This is the stuff that we should be teaching here in school. The new way of teaching needs to be changed. And the 60-second videos need to stop. Thank you for your time.
Thank you for your comment. Anybody else have a public comment?
Steve Bahujan, Forked River. So I had a question about the $58,000 cut to special education, related services, and also you mentioned it in the letter that came out on the 29th. I'm wondering if we're still in the middle of IEP season, how the director of special services can predict the deficit that the students won't need that help. So it seems like you're cutting the services even though the superintendent, the board members are not members of the IEP team and are not allowed to make that determination. So how can you determine that those students won't need those services?
We did not determine that.
Well, Mr. Bond determined it, you said.
He's in charge of special services.
But we still haven't had all the IEPs for all the students. So we can't know what they need. So, we're not even finished with IEP season.
So let me jump in, and then maybe Ms. Ormsby wants to jump in as well. There's a misunderstanding as to what that $58,000 has nothing to do with IEPs. Each of our administrators was given a task to trim the budget as much as possible, and so that was Mr. Bond finding efficiencies where he could that was not going to affect IEPs. For example,
Hiring the behaviorist.
I'm sorry?
Hiring the behaviorist so you can cut down on...
Right, and Ms. Ormsby talked about that. So perhaps looking at some of the contracted services, looking for people who are more affordable, and what were some other things that we talked about today with regard to that line
bring
item?
Bring students back to the district.
And some of it was just supplies and
right.
things like
so
that.
We're talking about supplies. Yeah. We're talking about ways that Mr. Bond was able to trim his budget without affecting IEPs.
Right. So special services will not be cut?
No, it can't be.
Okay, I just want to make sure.
Yes, it cannot be.
The letter,
and I knew you were going to ask that question.
And, you know, just want to be clear.
We were ready. We were ready for you.
Mr. Senza, did you have your hand up? Please state your name and address.
Regina DeSenza, Sunset Drive, Sunrise Beach. The Sunrise Beach Club will meet either on the 4th or 5th Friday of May. I'm not sure what the date is. And it's usually at 7 p.m. or 8 p.m. in Community Hall. But I can get that information to you if I can find it. It might be on their Facebook page because that's coming up. That's the only, you know, club that I know of. And it doesn't usually have a lot of people there, say 20 to 40, but if they That's knew good. You were coming ahead of time, yeah. maybe more people would come. So you can try that.
Thank you.
I had emailed Ms. Ormsby earlier today the status of the S2 case. Did that get dismissed? I wasn't able to follow it, so I don't know what's happening.
It's not dismissed. I actually reached out to Tom's River, who has a more direct connection with
really?
The lawyer. He was going to reach out to get more information. It's not dismissed. The last thing he knew, he said, was with the attorney. With the judge, I'm sorry. And the judge was trying to get more information from the state about it, but that's all he knew.
So how old is that case now? 5-6 years old?
It's by 6 years old because it started right after the S2 cut
started. Yeah, because I remember it from the beginning. All right, mm-hmm. Well, that's unfortunate. We have to hope that the judge would rule in favor of the, is it six districts?
They ruled in favor of the districts. It's just that the state has refused. Well, they finally released the formula, but it wasn't in any readable form.
Right, I remember reading about that.
Right.
Okay. I do get calls from time to time, and the public has asked me, how many of the Lacey students currently enrolled are receiving special services? When I was on the board, I recall the figure was around 25%. Has that number gone up, down, or stayed the same? Please save that for your comments. I don't want that answer during my 5 minutes. On February 14, 2024, my ethics hearing was held at the Office of Administrative Law. Our Lacey mayor, Mrs. Giuliano, under oath on the witness stand, when the judge asked her if the three of them, her and her two other friends with subpoenas, discussed my ethics case in the car on the way to the hearing, she told the judge as she stuttered a little and said, yes, we all thought this was a waste of time. See pages 41 and 42 of the transcript. I got it yesterday. And I will furnish it upon request to anyone that wants to see it. The hearing was public. Apparently coming to court to testify against me due to the written statement she gave to Sean Giordano, the former Board of Education president, in December 2019 was indeed a waste of time. The statement she wrote is better known as false witness, kind of frowned upon by both God and the court. I would never reply to a judge that getting a subpoena to testify at any court hearing is anyone's waste of time. The judge said it will be, unfortunately, many months before his written decision is rendered, maybe by the end of this year. So, unfortunately, the cash register is still running on that one.
Thank you for your comments. Anyone else under public comment? Anyone? We'll now close the forum public comment. Board committee reports.
Plus, let's go first. Sure. Finance. We know this is big, and you guys have been working super hard. I'd like to thank everybody on the Finance Committee.
I will keep it brief. We actually had three meetings this month, February 22nd and March 6th. It was myself, Mr. Armato, Mr. Connedy, Dr. Pereira and Ms. Ornsby. And we spent our time close to 3 hours each meeting talking about the budget, which you saw tonight, so I don't need to repeat that. It also came up for non-aligned raises and the superintendent and the BA contract, so we put that on hold right now, and we're deferring that conversation for a later day. We also talked about on March 6th moving of the playground equipment. That's $13,000. That's, I believe, on the budget tonight, but that'll certify the safety so we can get that moved over. On March 14th, that was our regular meeting. It was myself, Mr. Armato, Mr. Peters filled in for Mr. Connedy, Dr. Pereira, and Ms. Ornsby. We talked about the STEM Room project. This is still going on. At this point, we're having our lawyer reach out to draft a letter in regards to the damaged countertops, and that's where we are with that. The fire alarm, they're working on their second punch list. Hopefully, they'll be done soon, and then we can close that out. But the STEM room, the kids are using, which you all know, and the fire alarms are up to date. Synergistics, we briefly talked about that. We are going to have the representative come out, I think, at our workshop meeting, so we can discuss and ask questions for her, which is not scheduled, but I think we're doing it in April, Dr. Pereira?
She just stepped out.
She just walked out. I think we decided on April, so when we get that date, we'll put it out. And I'm sure that's the same time we'll talk about the budget. Referendum, not too much discussed. Where they changed the time of the meeting, and they're getting quotes now for a marketing service. Okay, finance, again, we talked about the budget. We also talked about the September question, which is very important to us to help get the word out. So if these letters have anything to do with just communication to the community, again, please let us know where we can speak, because then we can talk about the question at that time to try to get the word out. Of course, it would help us significantly. Question is not made yet. That's in progress. Linkit, we discussed a quote. It's for additional mental training, and that is on for tonight. School supplies, Ms. Ornsby led a discussion on three quotes for preschool supplies purchased through the preschool expansion aid funds. Food services, we had an administrative audit that was led by Ms. Ornsby, and the results of the administrative audit conducted by New Jersey Department of Agriculture. We also talked about technology, Manage Engine. Ms. Ornsby led a discussion on the renewal of Manage Engine. And the quote of the subject of the resolution in this will have it for this month. That is pretty much it. We talked about use of facilities and the workshop days, but we spent most of our time talking about the budget at length. And that's all I have.
Thank you, Ms. Class. Yep. Ms. Walker, can we have a curriculum committee report, please?
Okay, curriculum met on March 12th at 2:30 in the afternoon. It was Mr. Bill, Mrs. Amorato, myself, and Mr. Zielinski. We talked about out-of-state field trip for the men's and women's track teams to attend the Penn Relays at the University of Pennsylvania. They qualified for this event for April. And congratulations to them for qualifying. We also talked about credit proposals for graduating seniors. Mr. Zielinski highlighted the proposal that was moved to the policy committee, and it is on the agenda for tonight on page 7, number 19, policy number 5460. We also talked about our CUSAC monitoring. This is when the state comes in and monitors the district. CUSAC stands for, let's see if I have this right, Quality Single Accountability Continuum. They will be here March 27th, and the administration, they've been working diligently to get all the material together for the county and state that come into, it's the state or the county? State.
It's, well, the county, the state people from the county.
Okay. We talked about the preschool. Mr. Zielinski highlighted next year's preschool and provided a recap of the activities and building improvements that have occurred during this school year. The award for next year is over $4.5 million and will benefit 300 3- and 4-year-olds. We discussed the testing schedule coming up. We have WIDA testing, that's for our English as second language students, DLM, that's for special education, and NJGPA, and that's March 11th and March 12th, and that is for?
Juniors. It's a required state test for all juniors.
Let's see, technology, we just discussed what's not going to happen in technology for next year because of the budget. Intergenerational club, they met with members of the club from Pheasant Run, and they had a intergenerational bingo on March 6th. We talked about the personnel that would have to be cut with this budget, which was a very depressing conversation, to say the least. Health and wellness, we talked about, Dr. Pereira talked about on Monday night. We have a professional development at the high school, and then in April as well. Professional day was last Friday, and it was a staff health and wellness day, and I hope it went well.
It did. It was excellent.
Okay. And our next meeting, which is, we have quite a few things on the agenda, it'll be April 9th at 2:30 in the afternoon. Thank you.
Thank you, Mrs. Walker. Mr. Conley, could you please do policy committee?
Sure. Had our meeting on Wednesday, the 13th of March. It was myself, Ms. Claus, Mr. Bell, and Dr. Pereira. I think Mr. Zielinski popped in and out there. Discussion about varsity letters for the performing arts students. Discussed the policy, and we're looking into it some more. New policy heads up tonight is P5460 in regards to high school graduation. Revised the credits from 130 to 120. And then Dr. Pereira provided us with an update on the budget, and that was it.
Thank you. As far as the curriculum committee, it was myself, Mr. Armada.
Not curriculum.
I'm sorry, referendum committee. Thank you. Too many committees. Myself, Mr. Armada, Dr. Pereira, Ms. Ormsby, Mr. Zielinski, and John Smith, our facilities director, was there, also present. We had Mr. Hopkins from HVHC Architect, Mr. Dubwich from HBF Architect, Jennifer Edwards from Arcadia Financial. We had Mr. Solomon from the Bond Council, and we had Laura Bishop there from Bishop Communications. We spoke about the Bond Council, where we were introduced, and he told us his role, what he was going to do as a referendum process. Marketing, we met Mrs. Bishop, and she gave the committee a different description of her services and how she could help the district through the referendum process. And then we went through the entire list with the architect from point A through probably F. We went through and prioritized what needed the most attention in our buildings, and our biggest concern was roofs. And we started at 3:30 and we ended at 5:16 p.m. Next, we're going to move on to superintendent comment.
I don't believe I have any other comments.
Board member comments. On behalf of the board, I would like to personally thank Mr. Zielinski for taking care of things while Dr. Pryor was on a well-deserved vacation. We had a tragedy last 2 weeks ago, and times were kind of rough, and him and Ms. Purpurai handled it well. He was on the phone with me every day telling me the status of what was going on and what was happening. So I'd just like to thank them. The biggest help also that helped that, I don't know if a lot of people realize or not, but we had surrounding districts reach out to us to see if we needed help. We brought counselors in from Toms River to Southern to
Tom's River Southern, Manchester Vocational School.
Vocational School, Jackson, everywhere, sent counselors to our schools, high school and middle schools, to help assist with our students that were in need. And I want to thank them personally for that. Some of them sent them, some of them we called and asked, and they were there. So thank you for that.
Berkeley every day.
Yeah, Berkeley was awesome.
Central did, everybody did.
Now, just so you realize, Berkeley and Central, two different districts. So Berkeley was great and really helped out a lot. And I'd like to thank Mr. Roselli, I know him personally, for helping out. What happens behind the scenes? 3 hours after we found out how much funding was being cut, happy somewhat of a coincidence, but 3 hours afterwards, Dr. Pereira, myself, Ms. Ormsby, Mr. Zielinski, who else? Mr. Senator Amato, Assemblyman Rumpf, Assemblyman Greg Meyer,
and Township Committee.
Township Committee Tim McDonald met for 3 hours with us with our crisis. Just to let you know, within 3 hours of finding out, there was somewhat of a situation there where we had something pre-planned, not knowing how bad it was going to be, to help us. I'd like to thank the Township Committee of Lacey. They helped us out tremendously. They're helping us with our trash bill right now, which is a dollar or anything is going to help us out with our budget whatsoever. So I'd like to personally thank them for working with us again this year and helping us out with that. The board, thank you for all your help we've been doing recently. I know it's been crazy. We've been late night text messages, Sunday night, 9:30. I was on the phone, 10 o'clock, calling, sending text messages out. Never responded. If not, the next morning, because some of us are really early birds, 5 a.m. people. Something you don't know. Dr. Pereira and Ms. Klaus has been testifying in front of the state, telling how bad it's, and Ms. Ernstby also is, correct? Testifying how bad it is, going to the state, going to Trenton and testifying how bad it is. It's bad. That is it. Four comments. Mr. Conley.
We're going to be voting tonight on this temporary budget. I don't like where it's at. Nobody does. So we're all trying to work on it. Just bear with us. That's pretty much on that. If you didn't get your tickets already, Anastasia, the play at the high school is this weekend, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, 7 o'clock, and Sunday at 2 o'clock. Kids have been working on it since the beginning of January, if not even earlier. So, and that's all I have. Thanks.
Thank you. Mr. Amato?
First, congratulations to everybody that was recognized today. I mean, these kids work really hard. The staff members work really hard. It's a great opportunity for them to be recognized. So with all the things that are going on in this school that's driving everybody crazy, it's good to have the opportunity to recognize people for doing a good job. I listened to your story today, and I felt with you because I taught your son back in CCD a couple years ago, and I concur with everything you said. I've seen your kids in action. They are well-behaved. And so I don't know what's going on. But I will say I applaud you for coming out here. Well, yeah, I agree with you. I always tell my kids the best way to save the world is to take the phone and throw them in the ocean. But I applaud you for having the courage to go up there and tell your story. It's not easy. Allison does the same thing. She tells a story, and you know, it's creating awareness, and that's what we need more of. So thank you for getting up on the podium, saying what you have to say. But there's a lot of things that have to happen. I think the first thing that has to happen is we got to get our budget together. And then we got to go back to blocking and tackling old school teaching, how to read, how to write, mental awareness, why social workers, why. Let's get more teachers in the school.
What happened between where we went to school?
The world changed. The world changed.
A lot.
So
we got to get it back. So, you know, I always side with Mrs. Klaus on this one when she says, you know, let's bring textbooks back. Let's teach them how to read and write. My kid, he went to school here from Pigawingen to kindergarten to the eighth grade and decided to take a test over at Donovan Catholic. And we were shocked at the result. He's in all upper honors classes there, and he's flourishing. You talk about having the ability to socially interact. He has no problem socially interacting with anybody. And then one thing I'm proud to say, the phone's not in his face all day. Because he talks to people, he hangs out with people. He goes outside and they play ball or they ride their bikes. They do what kids did when we were younger. They scratch their knee, they get in trouble. But it's good, clean trouble, you know? Like, I was supposed to be at Johnny's house, but I went to Pete's house instead. You know, those kinds of things. The things that we got in trouble for when we were little. But to the community, I know this community for 18 years. And I've never seen this community fail. And I don't expect to fail now. I believe in the people that I sit on the dais with. I believe in the people that run our district, Dr. Pereira, Mrs. Ornsby, everybody else in that building. And I think we're led by good people. I just ask that you trust us on this one. We're working. We're going to work as hard as we can. We're going to get creative. It's not a good position to be in. But if I think if any 7, 8, 9, how many of us are up here, can do it, it's this crew here. So thank you for coming every month. Thank you for voicing your concerns, whether they're good, bad, or indifferent. That's the job we have, right? It's a thankless job. But we don't regret it one day. So thank you for coming up here, speaking your words, having the courage to say what you have to say, and know that we're working diligently on getting this budget where we don't have to dissect the school, okay? So trust us this time, and I can tell you we're in good hands. Thank you.
Ms. Walker?
Okay, I agree. A lot of the things I'm going to say are repeats. But first, I want to congratulate everyone that got an award tonight. Well deserved. I just want to remind everyone about Monday night, adults only. And on April 25th, the mental health. The last year, that was really, it was the first one, and it was really successful. We had a great speaker. I don't know if you're going to get him again, but great speaker. And the, what do you call them? The tables with all the free information were wonderful. So I know you've tweaked it a lot for this year, but I hope everyone can come out because it was really, really good last year. And let's see, Allison, right? I didn't get your last name, I'm sorry. I think your idea is great. Get the people to rally. And the letter campaign is already, I think, making some headway in the phone calls. But we have a governor in office right now that just, you know, is not going to be too supportive. But I think rallies when he sees big towns all together with their banners or whatever, I think that was a great idea. So something that we should contemplate and think about. I want to congratulate, special congratulations to the Eagle Scouts. We had two of them this night, and that's not easy to achieve. And when you get into your older grades, you know, boys drop out of Boy Scouts. By the time they get to high school, there's very few that are still in Boy Scouts. So kudos to them for sticking with it, for doing great projects, and getting this achievement, because it takes a lot of work. So congratulations. And that's it, Mr. Peters. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Bell?
Just a few quick comments. Personal opinion, and I started it up there. I don't want people to think that I let the banner down. People are asking what's happened to the education. 1963, the Bible was thrown out of public schools. God's been pushed out of public schools. We say the Pledge of Allegiance to the American flag, one nation under God, but our public schools are not allowed to have God in them. It's not going to get better until we realize what the real problem is. Somebody asked, what's the difference between the way we were educated and the way education is now? If it started in 1963, that would mean my parents were in school when the Bible was thrown out. Yet my parents held true to the Word of God and raised me according to it. And the Bible addresses every problem we're having in the public school. From the idea that kids don't want to apply themselves, the Bible addresses diligence. Kindness, we're dealing with bullying situations. The Bible addresses all of that. And so I don't want people to think that I put down the banner that I was carrying that I ran on. As I watch all of the problems that are arising from the budget on down, I'm thankful that when I get up in the morning or when I go to bed at night, I have a God that I can pray to and ask for wisdom on how to navigate these different issues. And I think more than rallying, more than any other thing, we need to diligently pursue the God of heaven and ask him for wisdom in what to do in this, and then watch as he gives the answer. And I appreciate the board that I work with, each one of them diligently doing their part and doing all that they can to help this district. And again, the teachers and all those involved. But I think most importantly, my father-in-law passed away 7 years ago. His life's verse was Matthew 6:33, "Seek ye first the kingdom of God, and all these things shall be added unto you." I think we need to get back to looking to the first things first. That's all.
And I just want to clarify, you know, of course, a Board of Education is made up of many individuals with many different belief systems, and we're respectful of all belief systems. But everybody who makes their board member comments, keep in mind these are board members speaking, you know, their own views. We do have a separation of church and state. It's right in the First Amendment to our Constitution. So, you know, I just want everybody to be clear that the board as a whole is not putting forth any particular religious doctrine in any way, shape, or form, just so that's clear. But that's not to the detriment of anything that anyone values or might be expressed by any of the individual board members.
I would like to point out that the Constitution does not say separation of church and state.
Well, it says that Congress shall make no law regarding the establishment of religion.
Right. Congress should make no law. Agreed.
Mr. Amato.
Hi, yes. I'm switching gears a little bit, and I'd like to talk about curriculum since we couldn't talk about it in the private session. Just real quick, I would like to read a letter that I wrote to the board. So recently, concerns have been raised by parents regarding a book assigned to 10th grade honors English, specifically The Absolutely True Diary of a Part-Time Indian by Sherman Alexie. So upon further investigation, it's come to light that this book has generated controversy due to sensitive topics, alcohol, poverty, bullying, violence, sexuality, and bulimia. So when I read it, sexuality was my issue with it. And I can read you some of the sentences why I have an issue with it. But despite this, it was included in our curriculum. I asked who approved it, and I was told 3 years ago our board members on curriculum approved it. So when you ask about curriculum, our kids can't sign their name, but they know a whole lot about sex, and that's a problem for me. So upon review, I find this book does not align with our curriculum standards and does not provide the educational value we strive for. That's my personal opinion. So to address this issue and prevent similar occurrences in the future, I suggest implementing a new policy, which I sent to the policy committee, inspired by practices in Middletown that offers clear guidance on curriculum selection and classroom discussions. Additionally, I request clarification on how we intend to address inappropriate book choice with teachers and how we can ensure more appropriate assignments moving forward. As both a parent and a member of the Board of Education, I'm deeply committed to providing our students with enriching and appropriate educational experiences. Again, we can't sign our names, we can't do math, but we know a lot about sex. Furthermore, it'd be beneficial to understand who approved Honors English curriculum and resources, but I was just told it was approved 3 years ago by the board. So clearly we all have different opinions on what is appropriate based on this assignment. So I can read you some of the information. You might agree that it's totally appropriate for your children to read. I find it inappropriate. So I'd like to read a little bit of this, but I see that there is a child in the room.
Thank you.
I don't know if the child would like to leave the room. I don't. I don't know if the parent...
I don't think it's appropriate to read it.
So here's the deal. It's not appropriate for me to read it, but yet it's appropriate for our teachers to assign it to our 10th graders. So that's the challenge I have. It's embarrassing if I read this. We'll all be embarrassed. But I was just told... I was just told by a member of our board here, our administrator, that the book is perfectly fine. So if it's perfectly fine, Skip, I'll give it to you. Why don't you read it?
Can I just suggest that you may have just made your point even more powerfully by not reading it?
Well, if anybody wants to take a look at it, take a look at that book that I just mentioned. You might want to write it down.
No, yeah. You were on the quick, that's on your, isn't that on your agenda for next meeting?
It's on my agenda, but 3 years ago this was approved, and if a parent didn't bring it to your attention, which you brought to my attention, we wouldn't know about this. So parents, please, ask your children what they're reading and what's being sent home.
Mr. Mott, I'm not trying to argue, but in defense of 3 years ago, the curriculum committee, there is no possible way for you being on the curriculum now to read every possible book that is distributed.
I understand, but things are passing through. Okay, well, so let me ask you a question.
You're on it, and I like that.
Yes,
but what I'm trying to say is you can't hold people accountable for 3 years
ago. I can hold the teacher accountable for assigning it because she read it.
Several times the board approved.
Excuse it was. I was just told the board approved it 3 years ago. I was told who was on the board committee.
We definitely have it on the agenda for next month.
Yeah,
I think we need to have copies of it so we can see.
But to be transparent, yeah. I think our parents need to know what's going on.
Yeah.
Well, since we can't talk about it privately with all of us, talk about it publicly.
Any that are interested can approach you after the meeting.
Ms. Klaus.
The only thing I want to comment on is, I forget who came up to the podium and mentioned doing class every day instead of block. Okay, we actually talked about that last year. We tried to implement that. Will, maybe you can refresh my memory. I think it cost an extra $1 million in the high school and in the middle school if we did that.
That was reducing the load of each teacher to avoid a six period, we call it now a stipend. That was a different conversation.
Okay.
If you take a 4-period block day and convert it to an 8-period block day, it's the same money.
Same thing?
Pretty much. That's a spitball. I can't say for sure until I look at
it. Okay. So maybe we can look at that again.
If you convert 4 to an 8, it's the same amount of money.
Okay. Well, that was it. I just wanted to address that. We did look into that last year, though. That's it. I don't want to extend this meeting. Thank you. Good?
Good.
Good.
Good. Everybody's good? All right. Let's move on. Are you ready? Mm-hmm. Under new business. Got page 2, A through 1. Can I have a motion, please?
I'll motion.
Second it?
I'll second it.
Roll call.
Mr. Bell?
Yes.
Mrs. Armato?
Yes.
Mr. Connedy?
Yes.
Mrs. Walker?
Yes.
Mr. Armato?
Yes.
Mrs. Claus?
Yes.
Mr. Peters?
Yes. Page 2, A2, list of bills. Can I have a motion, please?
Motion.
Second.
Roll call.
Mr. Bell?
Yes.
Mrs. Armato?
Yes.
Mr. Connedy?
Yes, but I need to abstain on 950927, 289299, and 283300.
Thank you. Mrs. Walker?
Yes, I'm going to abstain on two bills, 950, 927, and then 203850.
Thank you. Mr. Armato?
Yes.
Mrs. Claus?
Yes.
And Mr. Peters?
Yes, I'd like to abstain on 21120.
Thank you.
Pages 2 and 3, transfers of S1701. A3 to A5. Can I have a motion, please?
Motion.
Second.
Mr. Armato was first, and Mrs. Walker was second. Roll call, please.
Mr. Bell?
Yes.
Mrs. Armato?
Yes.
Mr. Connedy?
Yes.
Mrs. Walker?
Yes.
Mr. Armato?
Yes.
Mrs. Claus?
Yes.
And Mr. Peters?
Yes. Pages 3 to 6, finance facilities, A6 to A14.
All right, we have an addendum for number 11. The change is under special revenues. The number went from $7,533,541 to $7,885,167. And that's the only change.
Motion, please.
Motion.
Second.
Second. Mrs. Walker's second.
Roll call, please.
Mr. Bell?
Yes.
Mrs. Armato?
Yes.
Mr. Conity?
Yes.
Mrs. Walker?
Yes.
Mr. Armato?
Yes.
Mrs. Claus?
Yes.
Mr. Peters?
Yes.
Thank you.
Pages 6 and 7, tuition, A15 to A17. Can I have a motion, please?
Motion.
Mrs. Walker was first.
Second.
I think Mrs. Armato was second. Who was second?
Yes.
Yeah.
Roll call, please.
Mr. Bell?
Yes.
Mrs. Armato?
Yes.
Mr. Conity?
Yes.
Mrs. Walker?
Yes.
Mr. Armato?
Yes.
Mrs. Claus?
Yes.
And Mr. Peters?
Yes. Page 7, policy and regulations, A19 and A20.
You skipped A18.
I'm sorry. A18. Oh, my bad. Page 7, A18. Can I have a motion, please?
Move.
Second. Roll call.
Mr. Bell?
Yes.
Mrs. Armato?
Yes.
Mr. Conity?
Yes.
Mrs. Walker?
Yes.
Mr. Armato?
Yes.
Mrs. Claus?
Yes.
Mr. Peters?
Yes. Page 7, policies and regulations, A19 to A20.
Motion.
Can I have a motion, please?
Motion, Conity.
Second.
Roll call, please.
Mr. Bell?
Yes.
Mrs. Armato?
Yes.
Mr. Conity?
Yes.
Mrs. Walker?
Yes.
Mr. Armato?
Yes.
Mrs. Claus?
Yes.
Mr. Peters?
Yes. Page 7, HIBs, A21 and A22. Can I have a motion, please?
Motion.
Second.
Roll call, please.
Mr. Bell?
Yes.
Mrs. Armato?
Yes.
Mr. Conity?
Yes.
Mrs. Walker?
Yes.
Mr. Armato?
Yes.
Mrs. Claus?
Yes.
Mr. Peters?
Yes. Page 8, donations. Can I have a motion, please?
Motion.
Second.
Jack, second.
Doesn't matter.
Can I have a roll call, please?
Mr. Bell?
Yes.
Mrs. Armato?
Yes.
Mr. Conity?
Yes, and thank you.
Mrs. Walker?
Yes.
Mr. Armato?
Yes.
Mrs. Claus?
Yes.
Mr. Peters?
Yes, and thank you. Page 8, programs/curriculum, C1 and C2. Can I have a motion, please?
Motion.
Second.
Roll call, please.
Mr. Bell?
Yes.
Mrs. Armato?
Yes.
Mr. Conity?
Yes.
Mrs. Walker?
Yes.
Mr. Armato?
Yes.
Mrs. Claus?
Yes.
Mr. Peters?
Yes. Page 8, professional days, workshops, and travel. Can I have a motion, please?
Motion.
Second.
Roll call, please.
Mr. Bell?
Yes.
Mrs. Armato?
Yes.
Mr. Conity?
Yes, but I need to abstain on you, please.
Thank you.
Disarms me.
Mrs. Walker?
Yes, I'm abstaining on you also.
Thank you. Mr. Armato?
Mr. Armato?
Yeah, hold on. Yes.
Mrs. Claus?
Yes.
Mr. Peters?
Yes. Pages 9 through 11, E, certified personnel, E1 through E12. Can I have a motion, please?
Ms. Ormsby, are we not tabling 1?
Yeah, I was just about to say that. We're going to table number 1.
We're tabling number 1.
Yeah.
Letter E, certified personnel, E2 through E12. Can I have a motion, please?
Motion.
Second.
Do we need a motion to table first?
No, we are tabling it. No, we're pulling it.
Oh, okay.
E2 to E12, can I have a motion, please?
Motion.
Second.
I got it. Yep.
Roll call, please.
Mr. Bell?
Yes.
Mrs. Armato?
Yes.
Mr. Conity?
Yes, but on E9, I need to abstain on Mr. Dowd, and on E10, Mr. Angelo, Mr. Brandis, Mr. King, and Ms. Nemec.
Thank you. Mrs. Walker?
Yes, I'm going to abstain, though, on Mr. Dowd on number 9 and Mr. Brandis on number 10.
Thank you. Mr. Armato?
Yes.
Mrs. Claus?
Yes.
Mr. Peters?
Yes. Page 12 through 15, F, non-certified personnel, F1 through F6. Can I have a motion, please?
Motion.
Second.
Good.
Yeah.
Roll call, please.
Mr. Bell?
Yes.
Mrs. Armato?
Yes.
Mr. Conity?
Yes.
Mrs. Walker?
Yes.
Mr. Armato?
Yes.
Mrs. Claus?
Yes.
Mr. Peters?
Yes. Motion to adjourn.
Motion.
Whoa, whoa, whoa.
Would anybody like to sign the letter campaign?
Did we make a motion to adjourn?
Yeah, we did. Made a motion. We have to do a roll call for it. Do we have to do a roll call to adjourn? All in favor of adjourn?
New wrinkle, but I don't see anywhere.
We're out.
Too late.